everyone. Welcome to Really Living, a place of hope and wholeness. We're so glad you could be here today or online. Just thank you for joining us. I just wanted to, as we sing together, I just wanted to have a reminder that our holy God is in this place. He is holy. He is majestic. He is perfect. And if we could bring all our heart, all our mind, all our soul, everything here in His presence, and just remember that it's not about what He's doing for me in my life and what He's, you know, getting me through. It's of course some of that, but it's what He's done for us, what Jesus has done for us. He has died at the cross. He has bared all our sins. He momentarily lost connection with His Father. How awful, how hard that would have been. I can't imagine not having a connection, a relationship with our Father, our Savior. So just keep that in mind and let those words really, really permeate, really, really get deep into your soul and find what it is, what it means for you to worship our holy, holy God. Hallelujah. Let's bow our heads in a humble prayer. Lord, our Father, our Savior, our Protector, our Healer, our Chain Breaker, You are everything. First and foremost, You are everything to us. You are there in the good and in the bad. Sometimes we have good seasons, sometimes we have bad seasons, but You are there. You don't take away obstacles. You don't just remove everything. You see us through it. And we are so grateful. We are just so, so grateful. And we give You praise and we give You glory and we give You honor that You deserve. You deserve everything. Us more of a desire to serve You, not self. Release the self, release the ego, release the pride. Bring it back to You, Lord. Show us in Your infinite mercy and Your infinite compassion and love. Show us what it means to truly love each other. We bring You these songs humble way just to show how much we love You. And we sing with everything we have. We bring it all to You, Lord, in awe and in reverence. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
What then shall we say in response to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? And He passed in front of Moses, proclaiming, the Lord, the compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness. Though the fig tree does not bud and there are no grapes on the vines, though the olive crop fails and the fields produce no food, though there are no sheep in the pen and no cattle in the stalls, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will be joyful in God, my Savior.
Let's all stand and really show God how much we love Him.
Wherever I go, all my life, all I know.
exposed by the light, it becomes visible. For anything that becomes visible is light. Therefore, it says, awake, O sleeper, and arise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you.
Sometimes we go through life and we're just so busy, 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 and sometimes we're in the middle of a storm and our fire is just this dim. It's just dim. And God wants to grow that fire in you, that desire in you, no matter what circumstances you have, so that you can help others, awake something in others. God wants everyone in his kingdom. So awake something in you. Deep inside, find it that God has placed in you. The Holy Spirit is in you to move you, to show you the way, to be the light in your life. Take hold of that and awake something big in you, something powerful, full of authority, and show the way that God wants us to be. Amen. Let's sing Awake My Soul.
His praise aloud. sing his praise aloud. Oh, awake my soul and sing his praise aloud, sing his praise aloud. Oh, awake my soul and sing his praise aloud, sing his praise aloud.
Chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, so that we might die to sins and live for righteousness. By his wounds, you have been healed. Suffering, Lord, I will remember what Calvary has bought for me, both now and forever. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. You're so good to me. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. You're so good to me. God, you're so so good in every season. God, you're so good through every trial. God, you're so good. You're so good to me.
I am blessed.
I am blessed. I am called. I am healed. I am whole. I am saved. Jesus' name, highly favored, anointed, filled with your power for the glory of Jesus' name. God, you're so good. God, you're so good.
God, it's so good. But you know what is the best of it? That God is so good to me. It is so good to you. A year and a half ago, I have to go to Florida, and I was flying, but my plane was delayed. And I had to spend 12 hours in the airport. While I was frustrated, I was upset that my flight was delayed for 12 hours. I get a call for the person that I was going to be there. And she told me one thing that it changed my day. It says, look for a person in that airport that you can fulfill God's mission on his life. And I start changing my view, and I start looking every person as someone that can share what God is doing with me. And today as we pray, we can pray and worship God here at front or where are you sitting, and God will listen to you. But when we are together, it's something special about being us together that it helps me, it helps you. So I invite whoever decides to come to the front or being there, you're welcome to do so, so we can worship God. Heavenly Father, Thank you, Lord, for being with us. Father, you are holy, holy, holy. And we have our heart full of joy and full of thankful to you. You've been providing us with food, with shelter, with work, with your peace, with your love. And Lord, as is sometimes we may not see all that in our life, even though you're still there. And Lord, as we come today to worship you and to honor you, Lord, we ask that you enter in our life and you transform our hearts. Transform the way that I need, that every individual needs it. And Lord, you are a personal God. Thank you because you are faithful to us. Thank you because even though we reject you, you are there beside us. You don't force yourself, you keep loving. Waiting that one day that love, it will open the door of my heart and allow you to be in me. So we can work together with you, sharing that good news that you've been doing in our life. Thank you, Lord, because you work in us. And Lord, thank you that even though sometimes we don't feel you close, sometimes we may say, I have no work, Alex. Why are you saying I'm thankful for work? Or I don't feel God beside me. Or this week has been a really heavy week for me. But you are there. You are right beside us. Thank you for showing us your presence. And Lord, as we have a wonderful day today, with a lot of snow and reflect the sun, and it reminds me that cleans how you can clean out my sins and make it like a white snow. It's just because of you, not because anything that I do. It was what you do in our life. Thank you, Lord, for that. Lord, as we come together to worship you, to honor you, to adore you, Lord, we want to hear from you as well. And we want to hear your word, what you've been speaking to Pastor Frank through this week, what you're speaking through him and touching his heart. Bless his heart. Bless Pastor's heart and empower his brain so he can speak your words. And we ask that the Holy Spirit can translate it to my life, to our individual life. And we can live freer, not just by listening to your word, to allow you to transform us individual. So we become one as you pray. Thank you, Lord, for being so awesome and so good to me. In Jesus I pray. Amen.
Praise the Lord. We say that a lot in church. Praise the Lord. What does it mean to praise the Lord? What does it actually mean to praise God with everything you have, all you are? today we're going to start a biblical exploration of worship. I grew up with praise being automatically understood to be reserved. That's how I grew up. I grew up in this faith, in this denomination. And the way we did worship growing up, we would sing hymns from a book, and we would sing along with sincere but subdued hearts. And I will say, people were sincere for the most part. It was just assumed that any kind of celebration of who God was would be something internal. Is that something that you guys, some of you resonate with? You know what I'm talking about? It has to be personal. I remember, one of the churches I grew up in was Willowdale Church in Toronto. It's a big church. And it was that kind of church. We would sing hymns and so on. It was quite silent. And I remember there was a gentleman that started coming to our church when I was a teenager there. His name was Mr. Pompey. Never forget this guy. And during the sermon, he would punctuate the silence of the church with cries of, "Praise the Lord! Oh, yes! Glory!" And we teenagers loved it. Because finally, somebody's showing some passion, right? We were just used to silence. You know, people would just sit there. You know, they'd listen. When they would sing, you know, kind of quiet and subdued. And here's this guy just letting it out, you know. And so we thought that was great. We also thought it was kind of strange because we were so used to the silence. But we loved it. But not everyone loved it. Because he was approached by the church and he was asked to stop doing that. And he didn't stop. He just kept on going. Week after week, in that mostly silent church, here was this man who dared to let his praise show. In one of my previous churches, we went through worship wars. Do you guys know what worship wars is? It's when brothers and sisters draw lines in the sand about what they decide is appropriate worship. And it was a big problem in one of my previous churches. What we had decided, we wanted to have a praise team come, be a part, well, it's our, you know, our own members, but once a month, we decided we would have a praise session, a praise time where drums would be involved once a month. And some people didn't like that. One person with a very large chip on her shoulder began disseminating a sermon from a pastor that had been a hip-hop artist and now was preaching that the use of drums was evil. And so the worship wars began. So I saw this video, and I went through it line by line, and I responded to the video with biblical evidence. I stated that, hey, the scriptures has multiple examples of percussion instruments being used in worship. And I said many of these pastors' conclusions in this video were not based on scripture, but sorry to say, was made up stuff. And I'm going to give you an example. He said there are three parts to music. He arbitrarily said there's three parts to music. There's more than three, but he said there's three. Melody, harmony, and rhythm. You know, there's also structure and form. There's also texture. There's lots of different things, but he said there's three. Fine. Then he arbitrarily said, God the Father is the melody, Jesus is the harmony, the Holy Spirit's the rhythm, and since the Holy Spirit is the third in the Godhead, rhythm must be quiet and subservient to the rest. Yeah, that was my reaction too. It was utter nonsense. But some people were eating this stuff up. In the end, the church, after back and forth and after studying it and praying into it, the church decided, no, we're going to do this. Once a month, we're going to have this kind of worship. And three families left the church and went to another church. We can get pretty passionate about what is acceptable worship. And we use all kinds of arguments while we say, hey, we can't use drums because drums are also used in jazz, rock and roll, hip-hop, and etc. Of course, when we make that argument, we don't think about how piano and organ are also used in those kinds of genres of music, right? So that doesn't make sense. This same pastor said that the 2/4 beat is satanic. I have no idea where that came from. So I literally sent photocopies of, for example, of one of our hymns, Joy to the World, that's in the 2/4 time signature. And there's others in our hymnal, like The Lord is My Light, Watch Ye Saints. These are in the 2/4 time signature. Other people say silence is the only way to worship. Silence is the way to go. And they use this verse, "The Lord is in His holy temple. Let all the earth be silent before Him." Beautiful verse. I need you guys to know where I'm coming from. As a pastor, I've generally tested as an introvert. I'm kind of an extroverted introvert. And for me, spending time with God in silence and quiet is very important to me. I love that. It's needed. I love that we have the quiet time during the Garden of Prayer, a beautiful prayer, by the way, Elder Alex. And the contemplative songs that we have here at the front, they lead us in worship. These quieter songs, they do something to my soul. I love them. But people take this verse and they make the wrong theological claim that the church building is God's temple. But is the church building God's temple? Where does the New Testament say the temple of God is? We are the temple of the Holy Spirit. When we gather here, God's presence is here. If we had to go outside this building and worship in the forest, God's presence is there. He doesn't just dwell in an empty building. The only thing, theology we have like that in the Old Testament is when there was one sanctuary, one temple, where God's presence was in the most holy place on the Ark of the Covenant, the Shekinah glory. Yes, that's the Old Testament. But the New Testament, because of what Jesus has done, His Holy Spirit has moved in with us, His people. And so they make the claim that if this was the temple of the Holy Spirit, this building, well, therefore, we must always be silent, and that's the only way to show reverence to God. And I grew up with that kind of thinking. You know what's one of my favorite times to worship God? A thunderstorm. I love storms. And storms are loud. We can sense God in the quiet, in the silence, but we also sense God in things that have volume too. I look at this church, and every church I've been in, it's the same thing. One of the most important times for church, for me, is when the church service is over and we get together and we connect and we talk and how you doing and the relationships build. And you can see, you can hear the sound. There's noise going on. And in most churches, that happens right here. This is an auditorium. It's a little bit less comfortable to that, so people go outside. But in general, that is also a time of worship, a time of being with God's people, and we share God with each other. It's no less holy than this time is, or the music time, or the prayer time. Yet there's volume involved. I grew up where, you know, we'd have the ushers would be there to hush people, and they would let people out one row at a time, and it would be always just be kept quiet and quite dead. The idea was when you're around God, you are to be quiet. There's supposed to be little movement. Everything must be in order, and God is a God of order. He absolutely is. But we mistake that to mean that God runs the universe like a library. Shh. Yet God chose to appear to Job out of a tornado. In the book of Revelation, God's voice, it's like rushing water, thunderous water. Can you imagine? The truth is, we pick and choose from the Bible, here it is, what fits our culture and what fits our preferences. The Bible has many examples of boisterous, active worship, even in the temple, which we'll explore. And it's interesting, some of the same people that I grew up with that have a very difficult time or a very negative experience or put people down when there's any kind of expression of worship while we're at church, you should hear them when the Leafs are scoring and the Blue Jays get a home run and someone dunks on the Raptors, right? When it's their team that they're cheering for, it's totally okay to be expressive. And lest you think I'm this super expressive guy, I'm not. I'm someone, as I said, I grew up in this way, and I tend to find it difficult to be expressive in worship. When I'm alone with God, it's not an issue. But when I'm in front of people, especially I'm at the front, I'm like, people are they looking at me when I'm putting my hands up? I don't know. And I start thinking about it, and I find it challenging. So I need to learn what this is about too. The important thing then I want us to consider in this whole series we're going to be doing is let's put human arguments aside. Let's discover what is God's perspective on worship. Because if God is the audience of our worship, amen? He's the audience of our worship. He's the one that's listening to our worship. He's the one that's receiving our praise. Then it behooves us, it's important that we understand what is his perspective on this. What does God receive as praise? What is not worshipful to God? That's what I want to know. And the way to know that is to go into his word. Because if you want to understand worship, the Bible is where to go. That's what I want to explore with you, and let the chips fall where they may. Let's study God's word together. Because one of the things that happens with worship is we get really personal about it. And we have very strong opinions on worship. And one of the things I've noticed is that we tend to confuse our preferences with God's will. Let me say that again. We tend to confuse our preferences with God's will. That's a big deal. It's one thing to say, my friends, I didn't like that song. It's quite another thing to say, I didn't like that song. Therefore, God didn't like that song. Therefore, nobody should like that song or that instrument. Or that style of worship. Very different thing. Because now you're not expressing just a preference. You are setting yourself up as God. And speaking for everyone else what needs to happen. What is worship. And we dare not do that. My opinion does not equal God's opinion. So instead of hearing human arguments, God has given us his word, and we're going to go into his word today and learn about worship. Now, those of you who have studied the Bible probably know this about biblical Greek. The Bible originally, the languages of the Bible, where is Greek? What is the part of the Bible that is translated from the Greek? Where? The Septuagint? The Septuagint is the translation of the Old Testament from the Greek, correct. But that's not the original language of the Old Testament. The original language of the New Testament is Greek. What's the original language of the Old Testament? Hebrew. Very small parts of it are Aramaic, but most of its vast majority is Hebrew. In the Greek, did you know that there are four different types of words, at least four, that we translate in English as love? Give me one word you know in Greek that is translated as love. Eros, the first thing you said, Elder? Awesome, Colin. That's right. Another one? Agape. Very good. I'll put it on the screen. New Testament words translated love. Storge. Not a one you've probably heard it very often, but that's just natural or familial love. It's what comes out of us naturally. Philia. Philadelphos, the city of brotherly love. Philia means friendship love. Eros is sexual love, and agape is other-centered love. It's also the word that the Bible uses to describe God's love. Now, why am I saying this? We do not have extra words in English to get this, the nuance of these different Greek words. Well, what the English translators did with the word Greek word for love, same thing happened in the Old Testament with the Hebrew words for praise. The Hebrew words for praise. In fact, there are 7 Hebrew words, different Hebrew words, that in English we don't really have extra words to try to describe it, so we simply put it as praise. And they're found, all of them are found in the Psalms and in the rest of the Bible too. So what we're going to be doing over the next 7 weeks, besides next week is Easter, and it's a separate celebration, but 7 presentations, we're going to be looking at the 7 different Hebrew words for praise found in the book of Psalms that will help us to explore God's worship. And it's going to blow the roof off your mind as you learn, as it did me. I know it did something. It transformed the way I understood worship. And I hope it'll help us worship God in new and powerful ways. Sounds good? Okay. Let's start with prayer, and then we'll dive in. Father in heaven, thank you for this moment with my church family. As we dive into your word, Lord, I pray for your Holy Spirit to accompany us and to show us what is truth. That is the reason, Jesus, why you gave us the Holy Spirit. He will lead us into all truth. And as Elder Alex prayed, Lord, help it not just to be information, but transformation. Help us to hear your word and let it change us and make us more into your image. Help our worship to be authentic. Show us, Lord, what it means, how you understand worship, so we may praise you with all of our heart and mind and body and soul. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. So today we're going to explore the hands of praise. The hands of praise. It was even mentioned in the Sabbath school this week, if you studied that. In almost everything we do, even while you're sleeping, body language is being expressed. It's just natural. Watch a group of people talking. No one talks with their... Imagine if I was talking to you like this the entire time. Praise the Lord, and how's it going, guys? And my hands are just completely like this at my sides. It'd be very odd, right? Moving your hands is a normal thing, especially if you're Italian. Mamma mia. We do this a lot, right? It's just normal, this back and forth. Imagine you're at work and you receive an unexpected promotion, or you get news that the medical tests that you've been waiting for is completely negative, everything's fine. How does it get expressed? Generally, when you're joyful, the joy that is in you leaks out. Naturally shows up. It's not just joy. Whatever is happening in you, your thoughts, your emotions, your faith, your doubt, whatever it is, it naturally comes up unless you are unnaturally trying to clamp it down. And guys, this is a universal thing. It doesn't matter where you've come from, what your skin color is, what is within you, especially when it's great joy, gets expressed outward in the body. Anyone know who this is? Seriously, let me see your hands. Anyone know who this is? Okay, a few of you. Who is that? Droopy. It's Droopy. It's a cartoon character I grew up with. I love Droopy. Look him up on YouTube if you don't know who that is. Droopy's character is he's the most unexpressive character ever. Okay? That's Droopy. He would say things like this. You know what? I'm happy. Right? That was him. That's how I was taught to show God my worship. Praise the Lord. Measured, calm, rational, unexcited, and controlled. And the question is this biblical worship? Let's look at our first word of the series. It's the Hebrew word yada. Yada. We're going to get into some wonderful Hebrew words in this series. This is an amazing word found over 111 times in the Bible. In English, it's translated as praise, of course, but in the Hebrew, there is much more to this word. It means praise, to revere, or worship with extended hands, to hold out the hands, to throw a stone or an arrow. And you can look for yourself if you have, there's tools online that are free that you can look it up. Check for yourself. Always check for yourself. Don't just believe me because I say it. But you can go, for example, Jeremiah 50 verse 14. This same word is used to describe shooting an arrow. In Lamentations 3 verse 53, the same word is used to describe throwing stones. But in the context of praise, yada describes those moments when the Hebrew people were so overcome by the glory of God that their hands shot upward in response. Yada is praise in motion. That's what the word is about. Have you ever been at home alone or maybe in your car and you're listening to a powerful spiritual song? Or you're hearing a sermon where there's a point that really hits home. And you notice that your hands are reacting. Maybe your fists are clenched. Maybe they're just rising up. Maybe they're folding, right? But there's a reaction in your body from what's happening inside. Some of you may have noticed this. When I pray, I often do this. I lift my hands up. Because it's for me, it's like, God, I'm inviting you to be in my life. Come, Lord. It's a posture of invitation and of need for God. Fill me with your presence, Lord. Psalm 67, verse 3, let the people praise yada, you, God. May all the peoples praise yada, you. There it is. Imagine hundreds and thousands of people praising God with their hands lifted up towards Him. And implied in the song is not just that God's people are praising, but everyone in the world. May all the peoples praise you. That was a big deal for the Jews to say that. The Hebrews are saying, let everybody in the world praise God. Psalm 44, verse 8. In God we make our boast all day long, and we will praise Yada, your name forever. It's saying in this verse that Yada is not limited to a particular time in history. We are going to be praising God that way into eternity, forever. You know, we haven't reached eternity yet, but isn't it wonderful that 3,000 years after this psalm was written, people are still praising God with their hearts and with their hands. You guys ready for an experiment? This is going to be hands-on, pun intended. All right, while sitting in your chair, let's put your hands down by your sides. Make it real. Put it down by your sides. What we're going to be doing, we're going to be saying praise the Lord. And I want you to realize it's being directed to God, okay? Not to me, not to the front, not to your neighbor. You're saying it to God. First, what I want you to do is keep your face neutral. No smiling, no nothing. Just keep your face neutral. By the way, if you're doing this at home, please do it with us. The only excuse is if you're in your car. Please don't do this in your car because you need to keep your hands on the wheel. All right. You guys ready? We're going to be doing this together. Your face is neutral, hands by your sides, and we're going to be saying, praise the Lord. Ready? Go. Praise the Lord. Okay. That's good. Do it again, actually, one more time. Praise the Lord. Okay. Now, remain the same way, except I want you now to put a frown on your face. People say that frowns take more muscles than smiles, so I'm giving you a workout today for free. So do a nice frown. Okay, ready? Praise the Lord. Okay, a frowny praise the Lord. Okay. Now, stay seated, and now put that smile on your face. Ready? Praise the Lord. Okay, good. Note how you're feeling or what your experience is as we do this. Now do the same. We're going to do the same thing, but this time we're going to whisper. Ready? You could put a smile. Go. Praise the Lord. Very good. The experiment continues. We're going to shout it this time. Smile on your face. Ready? Praise the Lord. Very good. Okay. Now you know where we're headed. Please stand up. Yes. Yes. Everyone stand up. Hands to your side. Big old smile on your face. Now look up. Ready? Praise the Lord. Now, look down at your feet and say the same thing. Ready? Praise the Lord. Very good. Now, reach up to God as if God is about to give you a big old hug. Ready? Smile on your face. Go. Praise the Lord. Awesome. Please be seated. What did you notice from our little experiment? Was there any difference at all in the different ways that you said the same word, the same phrase, praise the Lord, three words, but was there any difference in the way it was said, depending on your facial expressions, on your demeanor, and so on? Any differences? In general, that's the case. For most people, your posture, your facial expressions, you know, your body language, your demeanor affects your experience. In other words, how we worship matters. Later in this series, we're going to see one of the Hebrew words for worship that is about prostrating yourself before God. Body language. See, what we have done is that we have made church exclusively about the intellect. But when you look at the scriptures, people in the Bible worship God in dynamic ways. It's heartfelt. It involves all of you. Put it this way. Imagine if Jesus himself physically came and was standing right in front of you. Would you worship the same way as you did the last 15 minutes or 20 minutes when we had our worship team here? Maybe not, eh, Don? And yet, isn't Jesus here? Now, guys, I get it. It's not easy. It's not easy for some of us to worship with a little bit more freedom. I know it's not for me. I didn't grow up that way. I was taught that worship looks a certain way, and anything else is sensationalism, exaggeration, and frankly, an invitation for the devil to take over. And for many of us, if we worship in a certain way, We were terrified that we might look like them. Who's the them? Anyone who's not us, basically. Anyone who's not like us. If I dare express praise with anything else than just a normal, monotone, quiet, kind of a quiet voice, if I dare to do that, people will think I'm charismatic, I'm Pentecostal, and any of those other churches. And I'm going to address that right now, because for me, this is one of the most hateful mindsets of our denomination, and we need to confront it right now. This is not about being Pentecostal. This is about being biblical. That's what we're doing here. So, folks, is there such a thing as an Adventist brand of worship? Is there an Adventist way to worship? Go to South America, go to Africa, go to Asia, and see the different ways people worship. Go in Toronto and go to some of our West Indian churches and see the differences of worship. There is no one Adventist way to worship. God, imagine God is inviting you to worship Him with everything you have. Jesus is standing in front of you, and you are being asked to worship, and you say, "No, Lord, I can't, because I don't want to look like that church down the street." When we do that, we've basically made it a sin to follow the Bible. We shame people for getting excited about God. If that's the reason that you're being held back, then you need to repent of it. Because, guys, for me, who cares if we look conservative or liberal or Heinz 57? Let's follow the Bible and let the chips fall where they may. Our goal should be to follow Jesus wherever He leads and stop worrying about how we look to others. We've got to get rid of that toxic way of thinking. But there may be some other reasons that are holding you back from expressing yourself in worship. For some of us, we're not comfortable showing our emotions in front of people. In my Italian culture, it's okay to be mad. You can show that. You can get upset. But don't show vulnerability and cry and stuff like that. Not so much. Except at a funeral. Then Italians are pretty expressive in that way. Maybe Portuguese is the same. And some people think, you know, what if people see me carrying on? And some people say, well, worship is private. That's one of the things I hate most about what's happened to Canadian culture, when people say, your spirituality is private, it's your business. Really? We can't talk about spirituality? We can talk about news, we can talk about society, we can talk about the latest Leafs. The Leafs score or the Raptors score. We can talk about anything, but the most important things of life we can't talk about. It's private. That's garbage. Show me a scripture about that whopper where worship is only private and we're not to show it in public when we're with, especially with our brothers and sisters. And there are some of us that might even be afraid that expressive worship makes us look undignified. A lot of Canadian culture is influenced by the British stiff upper lip. Some of you know what that means. I'll explain it. The upper lip is often the first sign that there's some grief or some strong emotions. It trembles, right? And so when the British say that you need to have a stiff upper lip, it means unemotional, stoic. Now, some of us here are very chill, calm people, and that's okay. When you worship, it's just calm, no problem. But some of the dead worship that I have encountered growing up had to do not with the fact that everyone was relaxed, but it was because of a crippling church culture. And it was because of a fragile ego, because people were afraid, what will others think of me? And frankly, it was because there was a fear of being vulnerable. We're a lot more scared of each other than we like to admit. The place, the one place on earth where we should be able to be ourselves and receive love and acceptance. Not endorsement for our sins, we still make mistakes, but acceptance of who we are and the different ways we worship. And we fill our minds with, what if, fill in the blank. What if this person sees me? What if this person judged me? What if I make a fool of myself? Let's finish with God's word here. 1 Timothy 2 verse 8, therefore I want the men in every place to pray, lifting up holy hands without wrath and dissension. You know, I say this here. For me, when I'm singing, Sophie, beautiful worship, all of you, all the praise team, beautiful worship. When I'm listening to you and I'm seeing the words, it is prayer for me. Because I'm seeing the words and I'm having my thing with God, which is what the point of worship is. Worship is a type of prayer. All of it. So remember, we're not talking about singing only, because we tend to think worship is just singing. It's all of it, the whole package. And here it's saying part of that worship is prayer. And we are being instructed to lift holy hands to God. Here's another one. 1 Kings 8, 22. Then Solomon stood before the altar of the Lord. Where is the altar? In the Old Testament, where is he in this verse? He's in the sanctuary, at the temple. In fact, this is the dedication of the temple. Solomon stood before the altar of the Lord. This is where the sacrifices would happen that would take away our sins. In the presence of all the assembly of Israel, and he spread out his hands toward heaven. Solomon is worshiping and leading an entire nation of Israel in prayer to God with hands spread out towards heaven. And he's literally doing it in the temple, where some people say, no, it has to be only silent. And you're supposed to only be quiet and not move. Lifted hands right in God's temple. I ask myself, why don't we Adventists see these verses? Why do we grow up with this culture where it's not allowed to be expressed? And we see verses like this where there is expression of worship. People are falling down before God. People are crying out to him. Hands are going up. And we just ignore it? Look at this one. Nehemiah 8, verse 6. Then Ezra blessed the Lord, the great God. And all the people answered, amen, amen, while lifting up their hands. Then they bowed down and worshiped the Lord with their faces to the ground. Two for the price of one. We're getting hands going up, and then people are falling down before God. Does any of us dare say that that would be inappropriate here in God's church? Why would it be inappropriate? God didn't physically appear there in the book of Nehemiah any more than he might here, but they're still worshiping him with everything they had. Psalm 28, verse 2. Hear the voice of my supplications when I cry out to you for help, when I lift up my hands toward your holy sanctuary. I think that was in the Sabbath school. Lamentations 3:41, we lift up our heart and our hands toward God in heaven. Internally and externally, we are praising God. Luke 24, verse 50, and Jesus led them out as far as Bethany, and he lifted up his hands, and he blessed them. The Son of God did it. His worship, his expression was seen and understood. Yada is praise in motion. And we're going to explore more about this word and the other words of Scripture in the coming weeks. It is praise in motion. Lift up the hands of praise in confidence and longing to our God. Let me close with this thought. This is not about forced worship. I grew up where we were not allowed to express worship out loud. It was something that was to be kept inside and was to be reserved. I was obliged to worship mostly in silence, eyes forward, and so on. Now imagine if we now say, now everyone has to raise their hands. That would be the same coercion. So please, church, don't feel pressured to worship in any specific way. Instead, what I want you to experience is freedom. Freedom. You can worship God naturally. If you want to close your eyes and sit in silence as you listen to the music, and you have some weeks like that where you're just tired and just want to live, then do that. If you want to stand up and you want to shout for joy or clap your hands, thank you, Melissa, for that. Beautiful. Lift up your hands if you want to do that. If you want to cry, then do it. Because God is worthy of all our praise. Amen? Last verse of Psalms. Psalms 150, verse 6. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Let's say it together. Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen.
Wow, that was amazing. Can you ever think of a song where you're just somewhere and it just did something to you, just moved you to tears, or it brought on this peace and this joy that came out of nowhere? Think of that right now and really raise your voice for our one and true God who's done so, so much for us.
I will praise the Lord at all times. I will constantly speak his praises. The Lord is my strength and my song. He has given me victory. I invite you to stand and sing with us. Raise a hallelujah.
Sing a little louder. Sing a little louder.
Hallelujah is going to be the second word of praise that we're going to study in 2 weeks. It's found in the word hallelujah, so we're going to be getting into that word. It's a very, very common word, very powerful word for praise. Wait till you understand what's at the root of it. It's amazing. Let's bow our heads as we raise our hallelujahs. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Father. Thank you for your Son, Jesus, Lord. The good news of Jesus, Lord, has transformed our life, given us eternal life, not just in the age to come, Lord, but even you said a hundredfold in this life to come, in this life now. There's so much goodness that's coming out of you. You are a good God, and we have so much reasons to praise you. We worship you, Lord. Teach us as a church your word, and help us, Lord, to have authentic, honest praise to you, Lord, however it gets expressed, whether it's in a quiet way or a more expressive way, as long as it's focused on you, Lord, and we're doing it biblically, Lord, then we're grateful and we want to do that, Lord. Let this be a safe place for all to worship you. Thank you for what you're accomplishing in our lives, Lord. Lord, when there's hurt going on and struggles going on in our lives, help us to respond with worship. When there's much to be grateful for and everything's going well, help us to respond with worship. When people are criticizing us, putting us down, help us to respond with worship. Whatever is happening, Lord, you are worthy of all praise, Lord. So thank you for what you're going to accomplish in your people, Lord, as we journey with you in your word and worship you and raise our hallelujahs to you. In Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. If you don't mind having just a seat, just so I can relay a few announcements to you. I'm going to ask for a little grace at this point because there are a few transfers of membership that I'd like to share with you. It's the first reading, and I would like to just let you know that Deborah Okumu, is she here today? Deborah? No. Okay, so I'll do a second reading next week, and then hopefully she'll be here so she can introduce herself to you. She's transferring her membership from a church in Kenya to our church. And we're also having a transfer of membership out. Florian Zernovenu. I'm sorry if I'm saying that incorrectly, transferring from this church, and he's going to the Toronto Romanian Herald's Adventist Company. So next week will be a second reading for both of those. I also want to bring to your attention, Davison asked, he's already sent an email to those that this is involving, but just a reminder for all teachers who are involved in Sabbath school to have a brief meeting in the meeting room just down the hall right after this service today. So if you are leading out in Sabbath school, please meet with Davison in the meeting room. Also, you'll see a table in the foyer that's for our Roots leaders. There's been sign-up sheets. Some are full. Some are still have openings for those who are interested in attending. So please, if you're thinking about it, just sign your name up to somebody who might live in your neighborhood or somebody that you're familiar with so that we can start Roots groups in April. Now, there is somebody in our church that I'm not going to name names, but you might know this person because during potlucks, this person quite often brings a certain dish that is requested repeatedly, and everyone enjoys it tremendously, and it's one of the first things to go. So the women's ministry department, our next thing that we're doing is we're going to have a cooking class, and Nike and I were privileged to spend some time with this person to be taught how to make this dish. And so we're going to be learning this dish in our next cooking class. And that's taking place, that's in their church bulletin, if you, and also in the Thursday newsletter. But that's going to be taking place on Sunday, April the 7th, from 12 to 4. So if you're interested in making a very tasty dish that I know you're all going to love, please mark that on your calendar, April the 7th, from 12 to 4. We're going to spend some time learning a few dishes and how to share those dishes then with our families. And then maybe we can provide those dishes to potluck. That would be awesome. Also want to remind you, this coming Friday, Agape Feast. This has also been put in our bulletins and in our newsletters, and we're having this Agape celebration. We learned what the word agape means today. What does it mean? Love. It's a love feast, and that's what we're going to be doing this Friday at 4:30 right here in this building. So we invite all of you to join. It's going to be a feast of praise and worship to God. It's going to be a feast that we're going to enjoy and fellowship with one another and just spending some time with each other, just meditating on the act of service that our Lord Jesus Christ did for us during Easter. So I invite you to all come Monday the 29th, 4:30, right here in this church. I also want you to mark something else on our calendar, and that's a church business meeting. If you've been in an Adventist church for a long time, you know that usually in the beginning of the year, we like to hold church business meetings. And you might say, well, why do I need to come to that? Well, you need to come to that because you're part of this church, you're part of this family, and you have a right to know what's happening. What are the plans for this church? What happens at our board meetings? What are things that are getting voted on? And you have a say. And if you don't come and things get approved and pushed through, then afterwards you can't say, well, I don't like that. Well, then you should have come because then you have an opportunity to have your voice be heard. So we invite you to come for our church business meeting. That's going to be April the 6th at 7:30 right here in this church. All of you who are members are invited to come. So please make every effort to come because it's really informational and it helps you to learn, you know, what is the mission of this church? Where are we going? Where are we heading? What is the next year going to look like? And so I invite you to please come. And lastly, I also would like, well, actually there's an Easter play coming up, 2:00. Rehearsals every Sabbath afternoon at 2:00. If you're involved in the play, please come. I'd like to invite Sasha. I don't see Sasha. Right in front of my face. Thank you, Sasha.
Happy Sabbath, church. I am so excited about today and nervous, very nervous, actually. But what's happening tonight? Food. That's the most exciting part. It's food. But we're going to have our international festival tonight. And Christian has scolded me 2 weeks in a row now because I forgot all about Romania. Like, how could I do that? And I've forgotten some countries, but Mikey helped me with this short video. And this should make sure I don't forget anybody. And then I'll come back and talk. Watch this up for a little bit. Hey, get excited if you see your country, okay?
United States, Canada, Mexico, Panama, Haiti, Jamaica, Peru, Republic, Dominican, Cuba, the Vatican, Tonga, Bahamas, Nauru, San Marino, Colombia, Venezuela, Honduras, Guyana, and still, Guatemala, Bolivia, then Argentina, and Ecuador, Chile, Brazil, Costa Rica, Belize, Nicaragua, Barbados, UK, Trinidad, and Tobago, Paraguay, Uruguay, Suriname, Tuvalu, St. Lucia, Montenegro, Norway and Sweden and Iceland and Finland and Germany, Azerbaijan, Switzerland, Austria, Czech Republic, Slovakia, Solomon Islands, Gabon, Poland, Romania, Yemen, Albania, Ireland, Russia, Oman, Bulgaria, Saudi Arabia, Hungary, Cyprus, Iraq, and Iran, Samoa, Serbia, Lebanon, Israel, Jordan, Myanmar, Kuwait, and Bahrain, the Netherlands, Luxembourg, Belgium, and Portugal, France, Georgia, Denmark, Ukraine. India, Pakistan, Qatar, Afghanistan, Thailand, Nepal, and Bhutan, Vanuatu, Cambodia, China, Mongolia, Saint Kitts and Nevis, Japan, Tajikistan, Laos, Belarus, Indonesia, the Philippines, Maldives, Taiwan, Papua New Guinea, Sri Lanka, New Zealand, Eritrea, and Vietnam, Tunisia, Morocco, Uganda, Angola, Zimbabwe, Djibouti, Botswana, Eswatini, Zambia, Mozambique, Gambia, Guinea, Dominica, Ghana, Burundi, Lesotho, and Malawi, Togo, Slovenia, Turkmenistan, Niger, Nigeria, Chad, and Liberia, Egypt, Benin, South Sudan, Tanzania, Somalia, Kenya, and Mali, Sierra Leone, Singapore, Mauritius, Namibia, Senegal, Libya, Cameroon, El Salvador, Cape Verde, Burkina Faso, DRC, Kurdistan, and the Ivory Coast, Kazakhstan, Marshall Islands, UAE, Congo, Republic, Comoros, South Korea, Armenia, Bangladesh, Latvia, Central African Republic, Syria, Andorra, Antigua, and Barbuda, Bosnia and Herzegovina, Algeria, North Korea, Seychelles, Kiribati, Croatia, Brunei, Micronesia, Palau, Equatorial Guinea, Grenada, Moldova, Malaysia, Greece, Guinea-Bissau, Ethiopia, South Africa, Madagascar, Rwanda, and Uzbekistan, Sao Tome and Principe, East Timor, Italy, Spain, Mauritania, then Lithuania, Turkey, Estonia, North Macedonia, Monaco, Liechtenstein, Malta, and Palestine, Fiji, Australia, Sudan, St. Vincent and the Grenadines.
All right. Did I miss anybody? Did I miss any country? I got it. Oh, boy. All right. So this evening at 6:30, we'll see you. We're going to set up in the lobby. Each country will have their table or tables. If it's a bigger country, I'm hoping that Canada will probably take up the whole space. All the Canadians, yeah? All right. So we'll see you at 6:30. Come with your food, dress in your costumes. We want your music and your dances. Catch you later.
Thank you so much, Sasha. All right, we're looking forward to seeing everyone this evening. Have a very happy Sabbath.